museum got a call a couple months ago from DC Comics, and they said, well, here's our idea. We want Superman to come to the Hayden Planetarium and observe the destruction of Krypton. Well, we all know in the profile of Superman, he left Krypton in this basket, Moses style, to escape the destruction of his home planet. If he comes to the Hayden Planetarium and observes the death of Krypton from an actual star, that star will have an actual distance. And if it has an actual distance, it tells us exactly how old Superman is. So, my task, at their request, well, actually, they didn't even know how to ask this. They just said, could they just show this? And I said, sure, you can show it. Why don't I get you an actual star? All right, they didn't even know that maybe we could do that. All right, there are star catalogs. Let me see if there's a star that is late 20-something light years away. Then it would have taken 20-something years for its light to get here. Superman is 20-something years old. He sees the destruction of Krypton. There's a huge effort that's been going on for the past several decades to catalog the nearby stars in the night sky. I look at the nearby catalogs, and I find a star that's 27 light years away. That's a nice virile age for Superman to be. And it is an M dwarf. It's red. So was Superman's home star. His home star, which I would learn in my conversations with him, has a name. It's called Rao. R-A-O, it's red. So we got a red star at the right distance. That star, as far as we know, does not have a planet, so the Krypton remains the fictional part of this. The catalog is called the LHS catalog. This is star number 2520 in that catalog. And so you ID the star LHS 2520. An added little feature, because there were several stars that I offered them, they said, let's pick this one in particular. And I said, why? Because I also told them where on the sky it is. This one is in the constellation Corvus, which is Latin for the crow. There are 88 constellations in the night sky. One of them is the crow. It's found in the southern hemisphere. And they picked that one because, something I didn't know, Smallville High School were the crows. You know, what more could you want out of this, out of how all this works out? All right, so now, what's next? Well, we've got to watch it get destroyed. Well, we have data on planets, right? No, we don't actually see the planets because they're too small, they're too dim, and they're lost in the glare of the host star. That's the problem. In astrophysics, there's a branch of our field called interferometry, where, you know, what you really want is the biggest telescope you can possibly bring to bear on your object. A bigger telescope collects more light, allowing you to see dimmer things. You can't make a telescope big enough to see the detail on Krypton. So we do something very clever and create what's called an interferometer. And an interferometer is, you know, I want a telescope this big, but this is 100 miles. I can't make a 100-mile diameter telescope or 1,000 miles. But if I'm clever, I can put a telescope here and a telescope here and observe the object at the same time and keep track of how I'm observing it with such detail that I can combine these two sets of data together and I'll have the resolution as if my telescope were actually that size. We don't yet know how to make huge interferometers using visible light telescopes, which is just an ordinary telescope. Visible light. So I said, here's what I can do for you. Speaking to the DC comic folks, I said, we can get all the telescopes of the world to observe Krypton at exactly the same time. Then we can pretend like we figured out a way to do it with our supercomputer that doesn't exist yet. And they said, no. You don't need the supercomputer that doesn't exist because we have Superman. So, an additive power that Superman now has because of this comic strip is that he can stand over your computer and use his powers to analyze and reduce data in such a way to create the world's largest optical interferometer of all the world's optical telescopes. And so he does this in our dome because we, before this, coordinated all the observations. He brings them all together. We project on the dome the destruction of Krypton.
I was wondering why you felt it was so important to have the science right, because we're talking about comic books and, you know, there's a lot of stretches of the imagination there, but it's wonderful that you came to it with this passion to make it real science.
That's an excellent question, and I have a simple answer. In my experience, my life experience, many artists don't reach as, many artists who are inspired by science don't reach as far into it as they could, I think out of fear that the science might restrict their creativity. So they take some of the low-hanging science, put it in, and then they wrap it in their storytelling. But I maintain that there's so much science, particularly in astrophysics, that if you did understand it, it adds to your creativity. It gives you more places and ways to be creative. So rather than constricting you, I think it liberates you.